the Puerto Rican Day episode, which I thought for the longest time was called the Puerto Rican Day Parade, but it's just the Puerto Rican Day for the name of the episode. It was definitely an interesting, like, behind the scenes story as to why they did this episode. It's also one of the more probably the most controversial episode in the series. And Skip Collector, who was an editor with Seinfeld for about 2 years, said this was definitely one of the hardest episodes that he had to work with. But the whole idea behind why they did this episode the way they did it was because it was, at the time, everybody knew that Larry was going to be coming back and only him and Jerry were going to be writing the finale. So this was kind of like a wrap-up, like a celebration, like the graduating episode of like the post-Larry David era, in some ways. And it was just the idea they were doing this. So they thought instead of like, you know, four separate storylines completely, have it like in like a big group, like where they're like wandering around, but it's all in the same setting and whatnot. Which I get it. So there had to be chaos involved some ways. And the idea of being like stuck in traffic in New York would be, you know, a perfect storyline for, you know, how, you know, impatient and anal the characters can be sometimes. And they picked the Puerto Rican Day Parade solely because that's probably one of the busiest days of the year. So it would make sense for that to be, like, a chaotic moment. And, like, you know, trying to, you know, get home because, again, not because of the culture, but because just the day in general is just busy in New York. Unfortunately, though, because they went with that aspect, it did cause controversy. And that and, like, some stuff that happened was reasons why this episode is not shown live. Which I understand. I mean, again, you know, like I said, I don't want to, like, you know, be taking sides or anything episode or defending Seinfeld or defending, you know, other things, but I get why this was controversial. Again, the whole idea was to take jabs at the characters and just, again, the idea of just being stuck in, like, a crazy event, but unfortunately, it was one of those things where it didn't sit well for some other people. And I understand why both ways. But again, it was one of the choices they had. It's like what's one of the craziest days of the year where again the gang could get stuck in traffic and like never getting home basically. And they picked this day in the entire year. So, the story started off, the four of them were coming back home, they were at the Mets game, and the Mets were losing 9-0, and I guess they left the game earlier, which I've done that before with the Pirates. One time I stayed at the, I think it was last year, I think it was, the Pirates were playing the Marlins, we were losing, and we left after the seventh inning because we were bored, but the Pirates came back and they went to extra innings and they won, I think it was. So, like, dang it. I mean, like, of course, the game meant nothing because the Pirates still suck. But, you know, but of course, the Mets this time probably were good. Probably around the time where they were competing for the World Series. Maybe a few Subway series in the World Series against the Yankees. This was during the time where I believe the Yankees won, like, four of the next five World Series victories or something like that. After having episodes, of course, where they shot on the Yankees for not winning a pennant in the episodes. But they were coming back. And first off, Jerry has an altercation with this guy who they kept calling him Maroon Golf. But the guy who played the guy actually is a good friend of Jerry's in real life. So, of course, friends poking fun at friends, you know, is, you know, something cool. But then, of course, they get back to New York, to the city area, and they're stuck in traffic. And they realize that it's a Puerto Rican Day Parade, which I believe usually shuts off Fifth Avenue completely. So there's no way they're going to be getting around them anytime soon. So trying to find some way out. But Elaine is impatient. She gets out of the car and tries to take a taxi. Thinking it's going to be quicker. Because her thing is, it's Sunday night and I need my time to unwind. And apparently she watches 60 Minutes. But of course Jerry says, you know, I can't stand that ticking. It makes me anxious or whatnot. But of course she tried taking a taxi. And it wasn't doing any better for her. Of course, she'd say, I could walk faster and then take a taxi. Every time she'd get out, traffic started moving. She'd get back in, traffic stops. She gets out, traffic starts moving. She could not win. Finally, of course, a taxi driver just gave up and drove off without her. George, meanwhile, though, was talking about some fictional movie he saw called Blimp. That there was this explosion in the movie, and I guess he always wanted to, you know, kind of, you know, like, shout something out just to get the audience to laugh and, you know, get an upper hand. Going out on a high note, get a high note, basically, or whatever he wants to say. Because that's how George Bell, you know, telling the jokes and, you know, getting people's attention and impressing people and whatnot. Maybe he can meet a woman that way, who knows. But, you know, it may not work, so he'll sometimes say something and it'll, like, you know, then he'll say something else and it'll just hurt the joke afterwards. But I guess he wanted to go back and see that movie again and sit next to some women, and whenever the explosion happens, go, oh, that's gotta hurt or something like that. So he, while they're in traffic, he sees that the theater right by where they're sitting at is showing Blimp. So he goes in and sits down, sits next to women who obviously have no interest in whatsoever. But George is thinking he can change his mind, he can get them to go a different way. And then problems arise. There's a guy in the theater with one of those, like, red laser pointers, who is, like, just pointing at, like, circling around the woman's breasts and, like, you know, just, like, doing goofy stuff with it and making people laugh. So it's basically stealing George's potential thunder. So he sees the laser pointer guy outside of the theater at one point and asks him if he can, you know, just pause his act during that scene. Well, the scene happens, and then the guy didn't stop. And nobody, you know, found George's joke funny. But then, of course, as he's flipping out, the laser pointer guy starts pointing the laser at George's head. And everybody's laughing because, oh, they're pointing a laser at the bald man. And for the rest of the stinking episode, George cannot escape that laser. It followed him around everywhere he went. And everybody kept saying that he shouldn't like get that in his eye because, you know, it could hurt his retina or whatnot. It could hurt his eyes. So he even got, like shades he put on. But then Jerry's like, well, what if it gets, like, underneath the shade? Could it reflect off the glass and then get back into your cornea? So no matter what, he was doomed. He could not escape it. He even thought he tracked down the guy on the streets. But instead, he grabbed someone else's pen he was writing with and ruined it and got ink all over his hands. And then Jerry, meanwhile, he was trying to go down a one-way street, thinking he could sneak out that way. Of course, Kramer's telling him, you know, be a bad boy. He even mentioned something about, you know, scamming his car to make it look stolen. That way he can get a free car and they can find some way to get home. Because the other problem, too, was they were listening on the radio and the Mets were actually coming back from that 9-0 deficit. So Jerry wanted to get home and watch the game. But, of course, they had no luck there. And then Kramer had to use the bathroom. Well, Kramer went wandering around the streets to just get back in the car like it was nothing because it was a hood down. He was even one time in the game where he accidentally sat in the wrong person's car. And then we had to go to the bathroom. He couldn't find a place that would allow people to go to the bathroom unless they were actually, you know, doing business at the restaurant. But then he sees that there's an apartment for sale. So here's another, like, little throwback. So Kramer poses as H.E. Pennypacker, to get into the apartment, to have an excuse to tour it, but to also use the bathroom. Jerry, though, meanwhile, was about to turn down the one-way street. Who's get caught by? The maroon golf guy. I think his name was Lamar, I believe it was. He cuts him off and is being a jerk about it. So basically, Kramer talked to him and basically got him basically saying, you know, I want your friend to put his hands in the middle and say, you know, I'm sorry and whatnot. And then he'll back up and let him go down the alley. Well, that worked out. And then, of course, at the same time, George came back from Blimp, was not happy because his line was not the highlight of the night or of the day. And then, of course, you know, they had that laser, you know, pointing on his head and George and just following him around everywhere he went. It drove George nuts. But then, as they're about to make the turn, Jerry stops and says, by the way, that was not a true sorry wave. So long, jackass! He's, like, all, like, excited. He's about to go down the street, And then here comes a bunch of cars down the street, and right in front was the cab Elaine was in. So it's kind of like they all, you know, came right back to where they started and got absolutely nowhere. And then all Lamar can do is sit there and go, so I'm a jackass now. And he just embraced that for the rest of the episode. He'd be like, hey, jackass, give me a soda. Hey, jackass, this. Hey, jackass, that. Jackass! He was just like, he loved it. He just embraced it. And he was very funny. I believe they said he's a real-life stand-up comedian. Because I think he also appeared in another episode. I forgot which episode it was. I have to read it in the trivia after we finished reviewing the episode. So yeah, they're right back to where they started. Jerry, though, finds out that Kramer used the bathroom at an apartment. Because they're actually, when we came back from the commercial break, they showed a shot of the of Jerry's apartment with nobody in it. And that was the only shot of the apartment the entire episode. So Jerry uses the apartment as an excuse to go upstairs and watch the Mets game. And he used the name, Kel Varnson, which was the name that Jerry used back in the boyfriend episode when he had to answer the phone and pretend to be Vandalay Industries. When, of course, it was Keith Hernandez who called him on the other line. So that happened. And then George eventually had to use a bathroom and also to wash his hands from all the ink on his hand. So he went up to the apartment and posed as Art Vandalay and whatnot. So they all had excuses to get into that apartment. Elaine, meanwhile, still trying to get home on foot because she needed to unwind. So they were staying at like an area where, like, you know, they couldn't cross, and everybody else there wants to get home too. So then they found like this underpass underneath the bleachers. So they went under the bleachers thinking to let them out, and it didn't work either because they hit a dead end there and they were all stuck down there. And there was this guy there who was actually played, what's his name again? Where is it? Okay, there was a guy there who was played by Mark Hirschfeld, who's actually the show's casting director, and who was like afraid of the dark. And there's a big dramatic moment where him and Elaine were fighting and they start making out for a second. I guess that was improv, I guess, just for the fun of it, just to be goofy, and they thought it worked, so they kept it in the show. But, of course, they end up getting stuck down there, and, like, no one from above them in the bleachers were even going to help them out, so they got all stuck down there. They had, like, food and drink, like, dropping all over them. It was a mess there. And then worst part of it was, and this is a big reason why this episode's so controversial. So Kramer finally was embracing, you know, the whole, you know, celebration and whatnot. And he had, like, a Puerto Rican flag wrapped around him. So he lit a cigar to smoke it. And he was talking with Lamar. Well, he tossed the sparkler that he used to light the cigar, and it landed on the flag. And it caught the flag on fire. And there is a shot of Kramer, which, again, as Jason Alexander said, the whole idea of this was for like a shot at Kramer for his clumsiness. It was not meant to be a shot towards Puerto Rico. But it didn't come across that way, and again, I understand why. So Kramer was trying to point it out, but everybody saw that. And of course, of all people to see it, was those gay thieves that we seen back in when they took that one dresser set that Elaine had gotten. Also back when in the AIDS walk, when Kramer refused to wear the ribbon. So they got brought back, and then they chased after Kramer. And of course, he had to pose as Pennypecker and go upstairs. Well, George was there. Jerry was there, and now Kramer was there. So Jerry's question is, who's watching the car? They look outside, and Jerry's car was being mobbed and beaten down. Probably a throwback to the handicap spot when Mr. Costanza's car got parked in that handicap spot and whatnot. And of course, at the evening, the car was, like, thrown into one of, like, the stairwells. So they're going to have to come back and worry about that in the morning. And then, of course, you know, Elaine finally appears again after she was separated from the rest of the guys for a while. And she was getting covered in, like, food and drink and whatnot. And, you know, they basically start walking back, which apparently I didn't notice, but apparently as they're walking away with like the closing lines, there is actually, you do see that laser pointer right on the back of George's jacket again. And they walk home, and that's the chaotic episode of the Puerto Rican Day. I thought it was good. I get what they were trying to do. They were trying to do with it, but I also understand why people took it as controversy as well. It was a risky story to do. I would say. I mean, again, like I said, I said earlier, the reason why they picked the Puerto Rican Day Parade was because it was one of the busiest days of the year, and they just wanted an episode where they had an excuse to have like chaos and heavy traffic. But again, unfortunately, it caused some controversies. But there's a lot of trivia, actually, from this episode, because it's controversies, too. So first off, writer Dave Mandel and some of the other writers in the show went to see While You Were Sleeping at the movies. And during the scene where Sandra Bullock asked, "Do you know what true love is?" someone in the audience screamed out, "Yes," which got a big laugh, which would inspired George's story of yelling, "That's Gotta Hurt," during that screen of Blimp. There was also media helicopters who constantly flew over the Universal New York City backlot during the filming of the episode, because a lot of people thought that was going to be the final episode. But of course that was not, as we have the two-part clip show and the two-part finale after this as well. Again, like I said too, Kramer accidentally burning the Puerto Rican flag caused great controversy among the Puerto Rican community, which is why this episode is not aired for reruns on television after it first aired. There was also, of course, Jerry Seinfeld. Shortly after the series ended, he performed his series of I'm Telling You for the Last Time concerts at the Bensonhurst Theater later in 1998, and a small group of protesters turned up across the street every night, and basically they were like, you know, shouting like, you know, things at him, accusing him of different things. And it was that bad that security actually had to be increased because of the death threats. But of course, he did, you know, talk to them. I think eventually cooler heads did prevail, and, you know, yes, the episode has not been shown on reruns again, but I think things calmed down after that from what I got from the inside look. This episode actually also took 6 days to shoot. Originally, it was actually to be shot in New York City, but there was no reasonable way to make it work, so that idea was canceled. So they made the show's regular New York City street set at the NBC Radford Studios and made it into a much bigger Universal set instead and shot it there. Of course, since they shot it over a period of 6 days, I think there was a couple of days where it rained. So, like, trying to make it look like it was all shot in one day was not an easy job to do, especially whenever they had to, like, clean off the cars from, you know, the mist and whatnot from the rain and everything. It was a difficult shoot. It was definitely up there with, like, that or the parking garage, the pothole. It was, again, despite it being just a one-location shoot for the most part, it was definitely one of the hardest productions, it sounded like. The episode was criticized not only for the Puerto Rican Day flag being burned, but also for its negative portrayals of Puerto Ricans, such as the scenes where an angry mob damaged Jerry's car, and Kramer says, "It's like this every day in Puerto Rico." NBC received a lot of angry letters, and protesters turned up at Rockefeller Center in New York. NBC, though, did apologize and later pulled it from summer repeats, and it began to appear in syndication and does feature in its entirety on the 9th season DVD set. But like I said, of course, it definitely, you know, is not really shown on for live TV for reruns because of the controversy, which, again, I totally understand. And then Mario Joyner plays the role of Lamar, a.k.a. Maroon Golf, in this episode. He actually originally appeared, actually, in episode 7.1, The Engagement, and he also made an appearance playing himself. He is a stand-up comedian, and he's also good friends with Jerry Seinfeld, as I mentioned before. And then there's a line also where Elaine first leaves the car and says, "You can't just leave this group." And Elaine says, "I've been trying to leave this group for 10 years. And of course, in some syndications, this line is cut. And after Jerry says, she says the line of, you know, "You can't leave the group," she says, "Vaya con Dios." And it's also was the last one, again, as I said before, this is an episode. This is the last episode that Larry David did not write. So it was kind of like the last regular post Larry David episode. Larry, of course, again came back for the finale. He had a record of number of writers, 10, including all the regular writers from the previous seasons. The on-screen writing credits were credited in alphabetical order without any, punctuation or, ands and divide. Nothing really dividing the writing into groups of writers, as all writers worked together on the script as a team, celebrating what would be their finale as writers for the show. And, of course, I guess Jerry had t-shirts made up for them at the end that said, "So long, jackass!" from this episode. Let me see here. I already mentioned that in the open house, the three male characters reprised their aliases they previously used in the series. George using Art Vandelay, Kramer using H.E. Pennypecker, and Jerry using Kel Varnson as well. Of course, Kramer mentions Bob Sacamano is there, which I gotta mention this too, because he was not in the finale, of course, but we never saw Bob Sacamano on screen. What if Bob Sacamano did come back, did appear in the finale as one of the people who, like, protested against testified against the four of them, but of course it did not happen. But that'll be a lot tougher when we get to the finale. And as I said, also the man Elaine kissed as they're trying to get out from underneath the stands is Mark Hirschfeld, the show's casting director. And then at the very end of the episode, the four main characters are walking away from Jerry's car. As they're walking, Jerry says, "Someone remember where we parked," which is likely a reference, of course, to the parking garage episode, which that is one of my favorites. But guys, that's the last regular episode of the series, The Puerto Rican Day. Again, a controversial one that they received mixed feedback, of course, from it, which I understand both sides. You know, I'm not going to take a side. I understand both sides, but I get what they're trying to do, gamble with it, but again, they definitely should have been a little bit more careful, probably, even though, like, once again, the intention was not to, poke fun at the Puerto Rican Day festivities. It was just to, have, like, a real-life chaos, a real-life event that would cause traffic, and for them to, go through this commotions of trying to get home and whatnot. But next, we have The Chronicle, the two-part clip show, which before I review those, I'm going to be going back and rewatching on the DVDs. Back on disc one, there was a featurette called The Last Lap, and there's also a featurette on the last disc called Scenes at the Round Table. So I want to try to incorporate what they talked about in those and put them in the Chronicle reviews and the finale reviews. So yeah, we have this four more reviews left for this review series, guys. We're now down to the bread and butter. We're going to just look back at the series in the next two episodes, and we will talk about the finale, and of course the aftermath of the finale, afterwards, and wrap up this review series. It's been a very fun ride, but it's time to finish. So guys, what are your thoughts on the Puerto Rican Day episode? Do you guys think it was controversial as well? Do you think this was a great idea to, to basically, have the one final, big hurrah with a lot of throwbacks throughout the post-Larry David era? What do you guys think? Leave your thoughts down in the comment section below. Be sure, as always, to slap a like on the video and subscribe for more content on my channel. And follow me on Twitter as well at DemandAirBoy93. Until then, guys, I'm checking out. I'll see you guys in the next two videos, which is the two-part Chronicle clip show, just looking back at the entire series. So until then, guys, I'm checking out. I'll catch you all later. Have a great rest of your day, and peace out, everybody.